Hello, this is Atron, and welcome back to Tutorial France. Last episode, we fought a war against England and wiped out their naval fleet. You can see we still got troops hanging out there. We're just about to enter the Age of Colonization, and we're going to take a look at the trade situation finally. I've been talking about covering trade later for a long time, and we'll actually get to it today, and you'll see why I've basically been ignoring it, and what my plan is for making our trade better. So, before I do that, let me make sure I can bring our guys home. Where are our transports? Transports. They're there. Alright, so you guys... yeah, that worked. Okay. I think. You guys sit there. Yeah, eight guys walking home. Okay, so we're going to do this. We can't land in England, so we're going to do this the slow way and march across the channel using the boats as a bridge. Doesn't really matter. They can hang out in England for a bit. We also still have military access with Scotland, so let's get rid of that. Free up a diplomatic slot. And the interesting thing is we started that war with England 2 or 3 years ago. And at the time, I was thinking the Iberian wedding would happen. And it doesn't seem to have. Castile and Aragon are not... Castile does not have a personal union with Aragon. And... That can happen in the game. There, the Iberian wedding actually has two options. One of them is for Castile to gain a personal union against Aragon and some rebels rise up that have to be defeated. The other event is that you can decline the Iberian wedding, marry a local beauty instead, and get a stability point and maybe some better relations. I don't know, but you know, for the most part, for a human, the choice is almost always obvious. It's so much worth having this land that you would always pick it, even if you didn't want to deal with the rebellion. Because actually, Castile, if they can keep Aragon as a personal union partner up until Admin Tech 10, can actually just integrate all of Aragon at zero local autonomy, zero core creation cost. It's just a thing of beauty, and you'd be a fool to pass it up. But the AI doesn't know that. And it actually has just a weighted chance of picking each one. So it has a 90% chance of taking the Iberian wedding and a 10% chance, or maybe it's even only a 5% chance of declining it. But I think they must have declined it, because that event, events in this game often have what's called a mean time to happen, which means that once the trigger conditions are met, they should happen within about that amount of time. And the Iberian wedding's a year, and it's been 3 or 4 years, so it really should have happened by now. So let's take a look and see. I think that there's a relations boost one way or another between Castile and Aragon. I got to this screen. I went to the diplomatic screen for Castile. You normally have the actions that you can take, but I can click on this to see Castile's opinions of everybody else. So let's look at Castile's opinion of Aragon. Yes, look at this. Aragon does not like Castile because Castile declined the Iberian wedding. So you're a fool, Castile. Great, but we don't need to worry about it. All that nonsense. I basically spent an entire episode worrying about what was going to happen when the Iberian wedding happened. Nothing happened when the Iberian wedding happened. Good job, me. Right, so there's that. So that means that suddenly a war possibly against Aragon might be back on. But I think I'm more interested in Burgundy right now. And in any case, we've got a ton of war exhaustion. I think I showed that a little while ago. Yeah, we got 2 years worth of war exhaustion here. We've got some rebels. Yeah, we've got quite a lot of rebellion over in French Comte. This is partly because of that stupid this thing, the unlawful territory thing. Yeah. That seems odd. It seems like we managed to pacify this. Oh, we had troops here, yes. So if we pile troops back on, it'll go back down to zero. Okay, great. So when I get troops back home, actually, these guys? Sure, we'll take you over here to start. At least reduce the chance. And as troops come across, we'll do that. We're very close to technology. We're at 625 admin points. Excuse me, that's diplomatic points. And technically, we need 730 right now as of 1476, January 1st, that will drop to 670. We'll still be a bit short, but we'll be really, really close. And we'll take that as soon as we can, despite the fact that we're paying a premium for it, just to get a jump in the colonial race. The problem, however, is we haven't actually discovered what we want to colonize yet. So, where are my explorers? Here they are. Explorers. Explorers are not in port. Why don't you get in port? That port will work, too. Alright, I'm actually going to go ahead and get those started off, and then I'll talk about trading a little bit. That was not what I wanted to do. Yes. Bohemia and Austria rivals. They fought a big war. That's not surprising. Okay, put the explorer back in charge. And let us go explore the waters of Amazonas. We actually want the waters of the Caribbean, but we can't reach them yet. So we'll do that first. All right. We could take an idea, but we don't want to because we want to save those points for Diplotech. Accumulate money? That's a mission, really? Gives us 10 prestige. Well, I'm probably going to want to do that. So sure, we'll take that, I guess. I mean, prestige not that valuable, but sure, I don't have anything better to do with these guys at the moment. All right, so I think that takes care of all of the alerts. And we've got ourselves ready to start, to start the exploration phase again, and end of war stuff. So let's take a look at trading. Here's the trade view. It's kind of frightening when you first look at it. There's numbers and arrows and stuff going everywhere. Trade works in this game. Every province belongs to a trade node, and this map mode actually shows you which provinces belong to which node. So all this stuff in blue, for instance, belongs to the Bordeaux trade node, and all this stuff in red here belongs to Champagne, and all the orange here belongs to the English Channel and Genoa and Sevilla and Venice, etc., etc. The ones that have this sort of check pattern overlaid on them are ones that I actually can't reach. I don't have the trade range to do anything to them, so I can't send a merchant, I can't do anything. And all the ones that I care about are not checked. So a trade node, you saw that, provinces produce goods. So this province produces 1.14 salt, and salt's worth 3. So it produces 3.42 value of salt per year. And that goes into I get some money based on the production value. I take some, basically some production costs out of that. So, but that doesn't just go nowhere. It goes into the local trade node. So all of the goods that all these things produce all go into the local trade node. And for now, I'll come back to this in a minute, but for now let's just think of them as a total amount of money. So we put in 3.42 from Poitou and 1.90 from Limousin and 3.68 from Berry, etc., etc. We add up all the amount of the provinces, and that goes into this local trade node. Yeah, so let's actually, these little boxes represent the individual trade nodes. So let's go ahead and click on the English Channel for a moment, and I'll cover some of this stuff in a minute. But yeah, you can see that local, there is 4.50 worth of trade being produced per month. It's the yearly value is divided by 12. That's all of the provinces in this entire trade node producing 450 a month. Actually, we can look at Bordeaux also. Bordeaux is 407. Champagne is 675. That's because it's got Paris and some other rich land in it. So that's the amount of trade that you produce, or that goes into the node. And trade can flow between the nodes, and I'll talk about that in a minute. First thing to note, though, is that in order for anybody to get any money out of trade, you have to collect from trade. You always collect from trade in your capital node. So for us, our capital is Paris, so we are collecting in Champagne automatically. That's what this little crate symbol means. It's our main trading post. So we collect there automatically. And when you collect from trade, you look at how much trade power you have compared to how much everybody else has, and you get that much of the trade. So let's take a look at here. There's a total of 6.47 plus 6.75, because there's trade flowing in, and I'll cover why that happens in a bit. But let's just say there's about whatever the math is, it's 13.25 or so trade value in this node. And we have, as you can see, we have, that's not it, is it? I think it's right here. We have 25% of the trade power among all the countries. It says collecting from trade, but that's not true. It's just 25% out of all the trade in this, in the trade power in this node. So we get 25% of that 13 that we earn here, and you can see that is actually 335. We have a bonus that increases it to 469. So once you get trade value, you also have further sort of efficiency bonuses that help you get actually more than you actually took out. So we took out 335. Burgundy is also collecting from trade, so they're getting 219. Brabant is collecting from trade. Actually, they're not taking 219. They're taking 183. Brabant's taking 85, etc., etc. So some of us are collecting from trade, and that total is actually 53% of the trade powers. You can see we're taking, we have 25%, Burgundy has 14, Brabant, Nevers, Liège. So that's 7.01 of that roughly 13.25%. And that always happens in your capital node. In nodes that are not your capital node, there are three options. One is that you don't assign a merchant there at all. So let's take a look at Saxony here. We have not assigned a merchant to Saxony. And you can see somewhere in here we have a tiny little bit of power. Yeah, we have 12.2, which is some small amount. I can't even find it on here. It's probably 1 or 2%. Oh, there it was. 2%. We have about 2% of the trade power here. And we do not have a merchant here. And the only thing you can do when you don't have a merchant is pull trade forward. So that causes trade to be transferred from this node to its downstream nodes. And nodes always have upstream and downstream, or they might have both, but it's always a one-directional relationship. So trade flows from this Rhineland, not Saxony, sorry. Trade flows from Rhineland to Champagne. It does not flow the other direction. And in fact, if you could construct the graph of trade in this game, is an acyclical graph. Trade can never flow in cycles. So this trade that is flowing out of Rhineland to Champagne can never come back to Rhineland. It is just gone from Rhineland forever, or at least until, you know, the trade balance of trade changes and less flows out. But whatever does flow out is just gone. So when you're pulling trade forward by default because you have no merchant, you pull it more or less equally. It's not quite that simple, but if let's say that nobody had a merchant here, everybody that didn't have their capital node here would pull trade forward, and it would be split 50-50 between this outgoing node and this, or this outgoing arrow and this outgoing arrow, because when you don't have a merchant, you can't direct where it goes. It just leaves. If you do have a merchant, you have two options. You can collect from trade there. So I could assign a merchant here to Rhineland and collect. I wouldn't make very much because I have such a pathetic amount of power here that it wouldn't be worth it. Or you can continue to forward trade, but now you can direct where it goes. And I don't know if I have any merchants doing that right now. I do right over here. Okay, so let's look at Bordeaux. And this is kind of dumb because Bordeaux only has one outgoing node anyway, so I really don't need a merchant here to be doing what he's doing. In fact, I might just go ahead and reassign him in a minute here. But we can see what he's doing right now. He is forwarding trade, and that's what this little arrow means. This means collecting from trade. The merchants of Brittany, that's Brittany has its home, his capital node here. Brittany is collecting from trade. France and Burgundy are both forwarding trade, and Castile's not doing anything whatsoever. That's because this node, Castile, can't do anything useful with it, so it's not bothering. It's basically just doing nothing. The game can't find a way to usefully transfer its trade power downstream, so it's to forward trade. So it's just basically throwing that trade away. So, in this case, not only are we forwarding 3.47 worth of trade up downstream to Champagne, we are also directing where it goes. So we would be directing that, you know, if there were multiple options, we would be making sure that our 3.47 flows to Champagne. Now, that gets back to the situation over here. We don't have a merchant here, but other people do. So let's say Burgundy has a merchant here transferring trade. So they're transferring 131 over here. And the Hansa is transferring 131 up there. And Brandenburg is transferring 0.54 up there. And Brabant is transferring some amount, 47, over here. So you see there's and you can actually see these little icons, the flag icons, tell you who's transferring where. So Rhineland has several people transferring and several people not transferring. The people that are not transferring when there are merchants present transfer in proportion to how much trade is being pulled in each direction. So because more trade is being pulled north to Lübeck than is being pulled west to Champagne, our minuscule trade contribution is pulling, you know, some amount to both, but more to Lübeck, because in roughly this proportion, basically exactly this proportion. I don't know what that proportion is, but something along the lines of 60% over here to 40% over here. I don't know. I'm guesstimating based on the numbers. So I could do the math, but I'm not going to waste time in a video doing that. So the upshot from a strategy perspective is a couple of things. First of all, you don't need merchants in nodes that you have massive control over, and there's only one direction to go. So we don't need a merchant here. He's forwarding to Champagne. All that would go to Champagne anyway, because we are not collecting in Champagne, and we have a bunch of power here, and that all is, there's only one spot for it to go. So we don't need this merchant here. So I'm just going to actually recall him. So he is no longer there, and that won't affect anything. And it's actually, those nodes are really good to have in your chain because you don't need to waste a merchant on them, but they still forward trade. And we only have two merchants. It says I have zero, but one of them is probably just not considered freed up. So the problem we have, and the reason I've been neglecting trades so badly is because, you know, we suck at it, really. We're only getting, what, 589 out of it? Yeah. And that's because our capital node is terrible. Champagne is, it actually makes a lot of money. You saw there's a lot of money coming in, but there's also a lot of money going out. You want to have as much control as possible over your capital node. And I mean something along the lines of 80 to 90% of it. Because you're feeding trade all over the place, you want to be able to collect that. It's some of it siphoned off at every spot. If you don't get most of it at the end, it's just kind of a waste of time. And it's actually really, really hard to control an inland trading node. It's because for inland nodes, you get trade power. I didn't actually cover how do you get trade power. Your trade power has nothing at all to do with the amount of money you produce. So despite the fact that Paragode produces 2.8 versus of value, it actually produces 3.6 trade value. That's because of how developed it is, plus a little bit of a thing called mercantilism, which is a percentage modifier to all your provinces. So if we look at Poitou, for instance, it's producing 4.9. That's because it's more developed, it's coastal, so it gets a bonus for being coastal, and it gets that flat bonus. So there are also these things, these estuaries, that just give a flat modifier to power. So the Gironde estuary, this is now a 20.5 trade power. So the proportion of trade power you have has nothing to do with how much value you're producing to the node. You want to do both, obviously. You want to have a high percentage of the power. Actually, you don't really care who produces as long as you have a high percentage of the power and it's worth a lot of money. So there are other ways to get power as well. So light ships patrolling in the area can give a static bonus. Let's look at Brittany. Yeah, no. You get a flat bonus to your capital node of 5. You get 2 for a merchant present. So I sacrificed 2 whole trade power out of my 152.4. It was 154.4 a moment ago, to recall that merchant and do something more useful with them. So merchant's not a big deal. Let's see if anybody has any ships. Let's find somewhere where somebody clearly has some ships patrolling. How about here? Does Holland have ships patrolling? Nope. Where are all the ships, guys? Yeah, there we go. Okay, so Flanders has a light ship patrolling. So they're getting a flat bonus, and they've probably only got one light ship. If you had 10 light ships, you're getting a 20-point bonus to power. And you can see that can be considerable. It can help you solidify control. So in coastal nodes, you can patrol trade with ships and get some extra money that way, or get extra trade power that way. In capital or in inland nodes, or when you're pulling trade to inland nodes, you get this weird bonus called caravan power, which is supposed to be proportional to the size of your nation. So, actually, let's look over here. If we look at France here, no, that's not a good example. Apparently, we're not getting any caravan power there. Possibly because it's already inland? I don't know. But let's look at, like, say, England here. England is pulling trade forward. You can see right here, they're pulling trade from Champagne to the English Channel. Because, of course, they are. They want to collect it. That's where their capital node is. So, they are producing 48. They have 48.3 trade power in this node, and virtually all of that is from caravan power. 2 of it's from their merchant, and 50 of it's from caravan power. Caravan power caps at 50, and theoretically, I would think big nations would be the only ones able to do that. But if you look, you know, Genoa, which isn't very big, probably has 50 caravan power. No, 47. Let's look at Provence. Provence, which is tiny, it's down to 3 provinces, still has 18. You know, Savoy has 22. So there's a lot of trade power in this node that is just leeching it out. That's this 47% of the trade power that's owned by all these people is just leeching trade out of this node. So I haven't been paying much attention to trade because we're not making much out of it. We're making 25% out of 2 combined nodes. It's terrible. You want, you know, a much higher proportion of that. So my strategy is to take over either the English Channel, which is, you'll notice, only has things flowing in. Anything that ends up in the English Channel is staying in the English Channel. So it's a fantabulous place to have your capital port. And the same thing is true of Genoa. Genoa is also someplace that the trade only flows into and never flows out of. So we will want to relocate our trading port to one of those two things. And we can do that without moving the capital. It just costs some duplo points. We're not ready to do it yet, but we will want to do it in the long run. And I'm actually going to choose, for the purposes of this particular playthrough, I'm going to choose the English Channel. There's a number of reasons for that. Part of it's that we already control one of the estuaries. I mean, we control an estuary down here too, or inland center of trade. So that's not such a big deal. But there's really not that. There's not as much power in the English Channel. It's generally a little bit sparser node, and it's relatively easy to control all more of it. And we more or less want this land anyway. So basically, all it's doing is encouraging us to take land that we want anyway. And it's, you know, relatively controllable if we take Holland and Flanders and these last two provinces off Burgundy, and we take over all of England, we basically have it all done. Whereas if you look at Genoa, it's all over the freaking place. We got to kill Provence, we got to take Savoy, we got to take two provinces back from Switzerland. Milan has some, Genoa has some, Florence has some, the Papal States, Siena, Naples, Aragon. It's just it's a mess. And you can see there's a whole bunch of these little things that are spread all over the place. So we'd have to go in and take an inland province in Florence. And you know, as much as I'm interested in Italy, you know, that's a really tall ask to get your trade node under control. So what we're probably going to try to do is focus on taking as much land up here as possible. We'll probably take a little bit down here. And beyond that, we actually just want to knock off these people that are moving trade. So you know, if we can move, you know, force Champagne or Naples or Savoy or Provence or I'm not sure what that is. Is that Siena? I guess I can see over here. Siena. So if we can force some of those not to exist, they won't be able to transfer trade anymore. And then here the biggest candidate is Provence. Because we want them to not exist anyway. So, and the other reason I'm choosing the English Channel, aside from it's easy to control, is that it's going to be easier for us to steer trade directly from the New World to the English Channel. So you can see the Chesapeake Bay node. So here's the Chesapeake Bay node. This is one of the nodes that gathers in the New World. So it gathers from here, and it can send trade either to Canada or to the English Channel directly. And if we were going for a, you know, Bordeaux heavy strategy, we could forward it up to Canada. Canada can send it to Bordeaux. You can actually see that line coming right down here. Yeah, Canada, Bordeaux. But in this case, we can just send it directly to the English Channel, where we'll have our main trade port. We'll get something like 80 to 90% of the trade here as we go along. Maybe start with 70 or so. But that'll make us a lot more money than diverting through this node. I could set up my trading port in Bordeaux. That's a perfectly valid option. But Bordeaux cannot collect trade from anywhere over here. And that doesn't seem like a good idea when we're going to want to push into, say, the Rhineland node or the Lübeck node and actually be able to transfer trade. So English Channel it is. And that's more or less all I have about trade at the moment. We'll be coming back to the screen a little bit now that it's a little less frightening. Ivory Coast, if you're planning on actually doing anything in South America or Africa or Asia, Ivory Coast is critical to control because it's the one that decides where all that stuff comes in. So it comes from Brazil here, comes from Brazil, comes from Cape of Good Hope, and it goes to, it's not showing us, but it goes to either the Caribbean, Bordeaux, Sevilla, or the English Channel. So that's Spain, France, England, England, Spain, France, and or the Caribbean, where you can redirect it to typically England, France, or Spain. So all the trade from the New World and that comes around the tip of Africa is either going to go into Sevilla, Bordeaux, English Channel, or there's this one weird scenario in which case it can go to the Caribbean, all the way north to Canada, and then over to the North Sea. So it can come in here. That means that Denmark's actually a viable colonizer. But we don't actually plan to get anything here. We probably won't bother trying to get control of this trade node. It's actually worth, even if you're not interested in doing anything else in Brazil or Cape of Good Hope or anything, it's actually worth taking control of Ivory Coast because you can steer all the trade. But, you know, whatever. We're not going to do that this time. I've said I wouldn't. You can see that Portugal has finished their... Well, I guess we can't see that it's finished their colony, but I bet they have. I wouldn't be surprised if they're... I think I see green right there. You see that border? I think Portugal's colonizing right here, which is okay. It means that they're not colonizing over here yet, although I see green here too. But that might be a green native nation. There are some natives over here, and I definitely know there are no natives here. So either Portugal has both or they have one or the other. Portugal, because they have these islands, has a much easier time colonizing down here. Less easy getting across the Atlantic. So, all right, let's get busy sending our troops home. We got a diplomat free. So, I want to start improving relations with Brabant. They're one of Burgundy's little minor guys, so you would think this is a little silly, but I think that we might be able to get them as a vassal if we take over Artois and get them loose. So we'll want to do that. And then I think I want to improve relations with Wales. Same thing applies here. Yeah, same thing applies here. If we can probably take Wales. We could probably take Wales as a vassal right now. Yeah, they totally accept. We'd need to get their relations up to 190, but an alliance will send it up to 177, and then a royal marriage will take it over the threshold. So we got a massive bonus to them because we managed to make their country exist by beating up England. And they like that for some reason. I don't know. Who knows they'd like existing? So since we have our diplomats going, yeah, our army arrived in the channel and is about to go home. These guys can go home. You guys can go over there. You guys can go over there. And I'll actually form these guys. Our sort of armies have gotten a little bit messed up based on the fact that I've been sort of busy doing other things. I was in the middle of fighting a war and wasn't paying that close attention to how I've got them organized. So these guys can come over here. Join these guys. Yeah, see, Brittany's transporting their men home. Why do I have a general still in charge? Why? No. No generals. No generals. Go home. Oh, I only have eight transports. Why was I thinking I had 10? Over here. There we go. Just march over to Alençon to get you out of the immediate area. Alright, it is now 1476, so let's take a look at the cost of that tech again. Yeah, look how close we are. We will be able to do it in April! Yay! Yeah, yeah. Over there, please. Oh, we have a diplomat back. Let's see, how's our paper relations? Sure, that can use a couple months of work. No, I won't. Yeah, thank you. Oh, Provence is allied Austria. That's not very nice. That means that they're not going to be happy about us going to war to take back Provence. But I have ways of dealing with that. And they don't necessarily involve backstabbing Austria immediately. Not that backstabbing is a thing not to do. All right, you guys. Eight more guys. Walk across the channel. And we could have done this all along, but our army would have arrived much slower and piecemeal, and it wouldn't have been good for an invasion. Alright, so we now have a bunch of guys hanging out in Franche-Comté and have pacified it, so that will cause our Burgundian separatists to tick down. I think we have some... Yeah, we have some unrest in Picardy, so we'll need to do the same thing. Apparently Barrois... it looks like the thing expired. Did it expire here too? It expired here too. We got rid of our unlawful territory modifier. Screw you, Bohemia. You didn't manage to make us have a rebellion after all. So I can actually send these guys somewhere else. I can send them to Picardy, as a matter of fact. Oh wait, no. I actually need them there for one more month to get rid of that rebellion. Fine, whatever. Do I? No, it's got plenty of... Never mind. I'm going crazy. Yeah. You guys group up. We should have just mercenary dudes in this one. I only have 9 mercenaries. Okay, fine. Go to Poitou, sure. Group up. And attach two. You guys go there. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to colonize right away because I don't actually have the thing that I want discovered yet. So this will take a year or two, but we'll get there. All right, arrived in Normandy. Last two guys, over we go. Definitely don't need 20 guys here. And I'm actually not going to take this technology. If it, if I wait till the end of the year, I don't need it before the end of the year, then I can get it for 60 points cheaper. So there's no reason to take it since we can't do it anyway. We're still reinforcing troops. Yep. And what do I want to do with these? We've got an early Carrick. We've got four early Carricks. Let's go home. We've got eight transports. Let's go to Gascony. I'm going to detach you, send you up to there, you two down to Gascony. I'm preparing these two. I'm going to need to send troops to accompany my colonists. The natives will attack them. Not so severely in the Caribbean where we're going, but it still will happen. So I'm going to send 2,000 troops over to the island to protect the colonists there. Alright, so we can... Whoa, what's going on? Stop. Too many things going on at once. So we can... there are claims that local fishermen have improved ship design. If we do a careful study of their ships and try building a copy, our best admirals believe that our naval technology will benefit a lot from the future. So we can get 50 diplo points and pick up some inflation, or we can get 10 diplo points for free. And how is our inflation? It's not terribly bad. Do we have an inflation advisor at the moment? No, we don't. Do we have one available? No, we don't. We have crap advisors. Yeah, really crap advisors. Okay, but I'm still willing to take... Yeah, I'm willing to take it. So, extra diplo points. Yay! And given that we have that many points, I'm actually going to recall this guy in the Papal State because... Oh, he's maxed it anyway. Great! Come home! And we're actually going to start integrating Brittany since we have enough points to do what I want to, and we have enough points to get the tech, and we might as well get that taken care of as soon as we can. Alright, what do we have left here? We have the Zerg fleet. Do I actually want the Zerg fleet? What is our force limit's 24? I think I would rather have more transports and heavies. So, thank you for your service, Zerg fleet, but goodbye. And I'll wait till I have more money before I actually start building more ships. Okay, and we're home from the Papal State. So we want to integrate our vassal, or annex our vassal. That will cost 324 diplo points, but it's only going to spend like 6 per month. And that will just come out of our new budget. So basically we're going to only make four per month for a bit. So we'll annex our vassal. You try annexing a vessel, unless it's a blood vessel. That's gonna be pretty hard if it's a ship. All right, we added another horseman up here. We need one more horseman. I'm trying to balance these armies back out because they got all messed up. You go over there, Yeah, thank you. What are you? You're a regular guy. So how about coming over here? So that should end up with hopefully 20. 9 and 2? Yep, that's perfect. That's 51. So two armies of 20, 9 mercenaries, and these two guys that I've assigned to the Colonial Guard. And let's assign them to the Colonial Guard. You are not Armée de Flanders. You are the Colonial Guard. Right. And Army... First Army. And Army Royale. Sure, that works. Catchy enough. Alright, where are our explorers in Romashka? They're coming home. Okay, so we finished the waters of Amazon. This should let us do the waters of the Caribbean next, and then we can do the land of the Caribbean, and then we'll be ready to colonize. And I'm going to increase the speed, because we're waiting for colonization to happen. We are waiting for war exhaustion to tick down. We've still got 17 months. I don't think we have much aggressive expansion left at this point because we fought a long war against England and didn't take any. Alright. Explorer's done. Onward to... No, I can't get it. So I've got to take that tech now so that I can actually... so that I can actually reach the Caribbean. So we'll do that now. Would have been nice to save a few points, but yeah, whatever. Okay, so now can you reach the... Yeah, look at all these things we can reach now. Waters of the Caribbean, that's what we want. So we now have a lot more colonial range. Excellent. And Provence has rebels. Ha ha. Greece declared war on Serbia. That's a little thing. People down in this area. It's Serbia and Ragusa, and I think Ragusa will lose this war unless they have very strong allies. Tyrone was annexed by Munster, so now this entire thing is owned by Munster. Munster has set Wales as their rival. Wales enter a military alliance with Scotland. And we're busy regaining manpower. And you can see we're integrating this. We're up 11.4%, and it gives us a little counter telling us that it'll be done in 5 years. So they'll be around for a while. Our diplomat will be tied up doing that for a while. That's the downside of big vassals, is that will happen. But it's still good. Gelray was annexed by the other Munster. Two Munsters at war. That's very confusing. And we're now into 1477. Milan was fighting Mantua and is done. Montferrat was fighting somebody. There it is. Milan was attacking Montferrat and won. And I think that was the war Burgundy was involved in. Yeah, so Burgundy's at peace now. But we'll deal with that. Oh, the Hans has rivaled Denmark. That's what usually happens. Scotland have changed their capital back to Lothian. England took it away, and I made them give it back. So, or something. Or maybe they took it back themselves. I don't remember. But anyway, it's a thing. A thing that happened. And, yep, here we are exploring the Caribbean. Nice little Windward Islands and Lesser Antilles. Okay, lots of stuff here. Yeah, no. Muslims doing things to each other. Traitor, that I don't care about. Yeah, none of that matters. Okay. And here, the Ottomans are attacking the Mamluks. This is another one of those wars that tends to happen a lot. The Ottomans really don't like the Mamluks. Generally, the Ottomans will come down here and just basically take all of this land off the Mamluks. The Mamluks don't have a chance. The Ottomans have insanely good position at the beginning of the game. It gets increasingly worse as the game goes along, though. As I said, really, you know, we're just kind of zooming along here, trying to get to the colonization phase. Poland is attacking the remains of the Teutonic Order. That will probably be the end of them right here. So our next war is going to be against Burgundy, I think. I'd like to take Artois. Do we have a claim on Artois? Yeah, we have a claim on Artois and Cambrai. We may take one of them. We may take both of them. We may actually, in the middle of this war, we may trigger the Burgundy inheritance by making them lose a war and having the King of Burgundy dies. And if that happens, then I'll get Rethel and these three provinces for free with no coring costs. So that's also a good result. But I'd actually like to get Artois and possibly Cambrai and possibly do something with Calais. I don't actually want Calais for myself right now. It's a little bit of a metagamey reason for it. If I give it back to England, England can pass an ordinance that will give it a trade bonus, and since I'm going for control of the English Channel, I kind of like to have that. I also can get a nice mission from that if England has control of it. So I want England. I'm going to basically force Burgundy to give it back to my other rival so I can beat them up for it later. The weird things these games make you do. And we're watching our Bahama Banks. Looks like Florida to me. There's Dominican Republic and Haiti. Yeah, there's the Florida. The Florida. The. And we're going to explore a little bit more here. And how close are we to military tech? Not all that far off. And do we have room? No, we don't have a whole lot of room right now. Champagne is the seat of a new cardinal. Yay for us. And we could take military technology right now. I'm not going to be going to war in the next year, so there's really no advantage to doing that. I'll save 60 points by waiting. And our war exhaustion is down. Yeah, that's actually a good question. If I wanted to go to war in the next year, I probably should be taking that tech so I can start building the troops that I need. I really don't have room at the moment, surprisingly. I guess I could fire some of these mercenaries. But I really don't want to do that either. Yeah, we have only room for one. 51 out of 52. We need more land. Well, we'll get some more when we eat Brittany. Yeah, I'll let it go for now. Yay, somebody's fighting a war that doesn't involve us. And involves some people that are allies with some of our rivals. These countries are fighting each other. What's this? Genoa wants access. Sure, go ahead. Nevers is getting integrated by Burgundy. We just explored the last thing here, which doesn't mean we'll go home because we've got to explore a little bit on the south side of Cuba here. And then we'll be ready to go home. And then we'll be ready to explore the land here. And then we'll be ready to colonize. Oh, that's not very nice. Thanks a lot, game. Just, you know, random event. Let's just screw you for 100 admin points. I want that stability back, though, so I'm willing to take admin tech a little later for that reason. All right. Finished exploring the waters of the Caribbean. You know what time it is? It's time to explore the coast of the Caribbean. And when did I fight that war with 190, that's probably enough. I was waiting partly on the war exhaustion to go down and partly on we still have a truce. Okay, well, we're definitely not going to war with Burgundy until we get the truce over. But let's look at Austria. Yeah, they want to, oh, they're just in massive debt. I don't think they even care about the debt. If they didn't have a truce with Burgundy, they would the 1250 would come off, and they would just have negative 74 reasons, and we have 87 positive reasons. So we could totally go to war with them if we didn't have it. We could break the truce and get a massive amount of war exhaustion and stability penalties, but no, we're not going to do that. Our truce ends in about 3 months, so we'll be ready for that war soon. Probably in the next episode, we will start that war. And Teutonic Order just got annexed by Poland. That was fast. Did you not have any forts left or something? Wow. Okay, Poland's strong. I could just leave that guy alone for the moment. Poland doesn't consider Austria. Poland will set the Ottomans as a rival? Okay. Who are your rivals? Hungary in there somewhere? Bohemia, Muscovy. What's wrong with Hungary? They're right next to you. You'd rather attack the Ottomans, who are way stronger and aren't next to you. I guess Poland has Moldavia as a vassal, so I guess they're next to Moldavia. But whatever. Where's our transport fleet? Where is it? Ah, here we go. Yeah, look at that. Look at that land. It's land. Watch him sail through the middle of the ocean, or the headland there to go discover land. All right, do we have this land discovered? Oh, we do. Okay, so we can go ahead and start a colony now. And in order to see where we can colonize, there's this nice little helpful map mode, as you might have guessed, called Colonial Map Mode. It's the cabin with the two arrows on in the second row. And so this shows the land that we can see. Green is stuff that we can colonize, and red is stuff that you cannot colonize of it. That's a surprising color scheme to you. So we can reach all this green stuff. We don't want to get on South America particularly, so we will focus on up here. And I'm going to grab the top one of the one that all these straits have so that I can just walk my guys from one to the other without having to send the transports back over. So we'll go ahead and send them to St. Kitts. Oh, and to actually get a colonist there, you click on the colony that you want to do, and you click send, assuming you had a free colonist. We don't have any more free colonists, so we can't send another guy. I could recall this guy. In fact, it didn't work. Well, okay, fine. I wasted one day of colonization. Oh, no. Oh, noes. All right, so I got my colonist back. So I'm going to send him again. And we are going to get, he's going to take 150 days to arrive there, at which point we will have the title to that land and nobody else can take it from us. And I only think one colonist can be on route anyway, so I basically think we have that land. It is now our Caribbean. We can see that nobody else has started there, so as long as we get ahead in the Caribbean, The other nations are likely to avoid us to start. Portugal will focus down here or over here. Spain will probably try to go over here. Assuming Spain can even colonize, which they can't. They don't have Diplotech 7, and they're not even close to it, as a matter of fact. They do have the Quest for the New World. We can see that because they have two exploration ideas. It won't tell us what they are, but they're clearly the first two because you have to get them in line. So Castile is probably exploring, possibly with this fleet. So they may see some of the stuff, but you know we're ahead of them. We're already started in our first colony. So yay us! Finally, I noticed that I didn't ever reassign this merchant. I'm going to send him over to the English Channel to collect from trade. We're getting a little bit of trade over here. We might as well get some money out of it. All right. Well, it's been a long episode already. We covered a couple of big topics. We've got our trading sorted out. We are preparing for our next war. We decided we didn't need to worry about the Iberian wedding. And we started our first colony. We're awesome. All right. Thank you all for watching. Have a nice day.